very much for the invitation. It is a really great pleasure for me to talk with and to all of you today. I would like first to give a brief overview of some of the things that we have been doing. And after that, we can certainly, I can take some questions. The focus of my presentation will be some work that we are doing focused on DNA repair targeted therapies and on immunotherapy. I just wanted to say before I start my presentation that not all of these strategies that I will mention today are applicable to all patients. One of the things that we are learning is that these cancers are very, very different. And one approach that may be great for one patient may not be great for another. Therefore, what we are trying to do is to tailor these approaches to specific patients and trying to understand who is more likely to benefit. In other words, as you've heard, I'm sure many times, not all ovarian cancers, not all uterine cancers, not all cervical cancers are created equal. Not even within histologies, for example, not even all high-grade serous ovarian cancers are created equal. So I apologize beforehand for not being able to talk about therapies that are applicable for all the patients that are probably listening to this today. And I will not be able to talk about all the different diseases and all of the different flavors of the diseases that are there. But on the other hand, what I can say is that we now are much better in understanding patients, many of the patients' diseases at the molecular level and tailor our approaches accordingly. I can't say we can do it for all patients, but we're getting there. So I will discuss about three things today. The first thing, which is relevant to DNA repair, I will talk about our Center for BRCA and related genes, which is a newly formed center that I am actually honored to direct here at Dana-Farber. The second is I'm going to discuss about immunotherapy and specifically our focus on neoantigen vaccines. And thirdly, I'm going to talk very, very briefly about antibody drug conjugates, because there is a lot of interest in this field, given that two drugs, one in cervical cancer was recently approved, and another in ovarian is likely to be approved very, very shortly. So I'm going to start first with a newly formed BRCA center. This is one of the very few dedicated BRCA centers worldwide, and was developed to address the population of our cancer patients with mutations in BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes, but also patients with mutations in what we call BRCA-related genes. In other words, genes that behave like BRCA1 and BRCA2. There are many of these genes, as I will discuss later. As genetic testing has become accessible to more patients with different cancer types, not just breast and ovarian cancer, there is an ever-growing population of patients who we identify that have heritable mutations in these genes, and this has major implications not only for themselves as cancer patients, but also for their families. Furthermore, what we do here, as you know, at Dana-Farber, we do testing in the tumor, and we're seeing a lot of patients who have mutations in these genes only in the cancers, or as we call those, these are somatic mutations. In other words, these patients do not have heritable mutations in these genes, but rather they have acquired mutations. We call these somatic mutations. To understand the extent and scope of this problem and this challenge, we have as high as 30% of patients with breast, ovarian, pancreatic, and prostate cancer who have these mutations in BRCA and related genes. And these patients who have these cancers have several similarities in terms of how these cancers behave and how we can best treat them. But there are also important differences depending on the specific mutation and also the specific disease. And that's where our cancer or this BRCA center comes. So besides trying to provide clinical care to these patients, our Center for BRCA and Related Genes wishes to make fundamental contribution into understanding the biology of these cancers to pave the way for the development and delivery of novel therapies for all of these patients, as well as novel strategies, not only for therapy, but also for prevention of these cancers, as well as for early detection of these cancers. I would like to emphasize that unlike the very few current BRCA centers, our BRCA center aims to have an active clinical presence through an active and innovative clinical trial program that directly offers new therapies and new risk reduction and early detection strategies to patients with several different diseases. And these are the main goals of our center. First, develop new treatments, identify and test new treatments. Second, prevent cancer development, identify, in other words, novel strategies to help prevent or reduce the risk of development of cancer in patients with inherited mutations in BRCA and other related genes. Third, to detect cancer early. And fourth, to understand and overcome resistance to current and novel therapies. Resistance is perhaps the most important and most immediate challenge that our patients face. For all of these priorities and for all of this to be fruitful, we need an active clinical program, which we have been developing and establishing, that we offer this all of this treatments for our patients. So what is BRCA? What is BRCA1 and BRCA2? What are these BRCA-related genes to? So one of the important aspects and concepts that is important to understand is what we call DNA damage response. So constantly, the DNA, our DNA, undergoes damage. It can go damaged from different ways. Damage from radiation, damage from viral infection, damage from chemical exposure. And this damage, when that happens to the DNA, what happens then is a very sophisticated program gets activated that tells the cells to stop multiplying. And then a very specific and very sophisticated repair of that DNA damage happens. And there are a number of different DNA damage pathways that are involved, and we call them, they're very, very many different pathways that depend on what type of damage exists and happens to the DNA. For example, if there is a damage in one strand of the DNA, we call this a single strand break damage, that leads to certain DNA repair pathways. One of them is called base excision repair. Another one is called nucleotide excision repair. Another one is mismatch repair. When there are two breaks in both helices of both strands of the DNA, we call that a double strand break. And that's where other pathways, DNA repair pathways, are involved. And these are called homologous recombination or non-homologous end joining. So all of these pathways are there to essentially promote and make sure that the DNA damage is repaired effectively and correctly. And if that doesn't happen, then unfortunately new mutations happen. That's how tumors, cancers develop. And that's how also cancers spread. That's how cancers develop resistance. That's how, you know, they do all these bad things that cancers can do. So I'm going to focus on one very particular pathway called homologous recombination. And that pathway is responsible for repairing double strand breaks in the DNA. And this is the pathway that, as we see here, includes the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes. And these genes play a very important role in this pathway called homologous recombination. And when there are mutations or changes in these two genes, then we have what we call deficiency in homologous recombination, which is quite prevalent in certain cancer types. However, as we see in this figure here, it's not just BRCA1 and BRCA2 that are involved in this pathway. There are several other genes that are involved in these very sophisticated pathways. And many times we don't see mutations in BRCA1 and BRCA2, but we may see mutations in other genes that are in this pathway. For example, RAD51C, RAD51D, CHEK2, ATM, PALB2, Fanconi anemia genes. So there are a number of genes that factor in this pathway. And whenever these genes are altered, then we have a, what we call a deficiency in homologous recombination, and essentially a similar effect as the BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations or alterations happen. And this is why we call our center BRCA and related genes, because we look at patients, not only who have BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, but also on patients who have mutations in other genes that behave like BRCA1 and BRCA2. And this concept is perhaps best exemplified in the case of high-grade serous ovarian cancer, which is the most common type of ovarian cancer, where, as you see in this slide, approximately 50% of this pie chart here shows different alterations that can lead to what we call a deficient homologous recombination DNA repair. So about 20% of patients have BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations. And as you see here, some of these mutations can be germline, which are heritable. In other words, about 8% of patients have BRCA1 germline mutations. Another 6% have BRCA2 germline mutation. But there are also this very small number of patients, but these patients do exist, that have BRCA1 somatic mutations and BRCA2 somatic mutations at 3% each. These mutations exist only in the tumor. They're not heritable, and we do find them. Other patients may have other mutations or other alterations in other genes that I mentioned here, for example, CDK12, RAD51C, I mentioned PALB2, and other mutations that can lead to what we call this homologous recombination deficient. And I want to say a few things again, because it's important to understand the difference between somatic and germline mutations. We call certain mutations are germline, as you see here on the right, when they are heritable. In other words, these mutations are present in the egg or the sperm, and they are transmitted from the parent to the child. And there is a 50% chance that a mutation from the parent can go to the child, and all the cells in the child will have this particular mutation. So you can a patient can have a BRCA1 or BRCA2 germline mutation that has inherited this from one of their parents. But there is also a possibility that they may have a somatic mutation that's not heritable, did not come from the parents, but rather this mutation exists only in the tumor. For example, they can have an ovarian cancer that has a somatic BRCA1 or a somatic BRCA2 mutation, or a somatic mutation in another homologous recombination gene. So that's a very, very important thing to know. So as I said here, there are BRCA1 germline, but there are also BRCA1 somatic mutations. There are BRCA2 germline mutations, but there are also BRCA2 somatic mutations. And we know about those mutations by doing specific testing on the tumor, or to find the germline mutations, we look at mutations in the blood to look at whether these mutations exist. So all of these tumors that have this mutations in those genes that are involved in this pathway called homologous recombination. So all of these genes, if they are mutated, that confers a very, very good response to PARP inhibitor therapy. So these tumors can respond very, very well to PARP inhibitors. And as I mentioned here in this slide, there are three PARP inhibitors now FDA approved in ovarian cancer. There are two PARP inhibitors in breast, two PARP inhibitors in prostate cancer. And there are also PARP inhibitors. There is one PARP inhibitor, olaparib, that's also FDA approved in pancreatic cancer. This drug, again, do not work for all of these tumors, but if mutations exist in genes that I mentioned, for example, the BRCA and BRCA related genes, then these drugs can have very, very good activity. And I personally have some patients who have an endometrial cancer or cervical cancer who happen to have these mutations. They're not many. These mutations are rare in these tumors. But if they do, they actually can respond very, very well to PARP inhibitors. And in other words, these drugs can be effective even if this is not an ovarian or a breast or a prostate or a pancreatic cancer. However, one of the biggest problems that we face is that sometimes resistance to the PARP inhibitors develops. And this is one of the key areas of focus for our center, especially now that the PARP inhibitors are FDA approved in so many cancers and therefore are widely available for a lot of patients. I'm not going to go through their number of different mechanisms of resistance. Some of them we have recognized here in Dana-Farber, and many more are being identified. But it's important to try not only to identify novel mechanisms of resistance, but most importantly, to develop novel strategies to overcome this specific mechanism of resistance using a mechanism-specific approach to provide our patients with novel therapies for those patients who develop resistance to PARP inhibitor. So why do we do a BRCA center now? Why did we develop this? First of all, good news, there are multiple novel therapies that are becoming available for patients with BRCA and related cancers. And again, I'm talking about BRCA and BRCA related cancers, not just BRCA1 and BRCA2, but also other genes that are behaving similarly as BRCA. It is not an overstatement to say that this is actually a true revolution in the development of novel DNA damage response inhibitors. And there are drugs now that target a number of proteins that are involved in DNA damage signaling, in DNA repair, in metabolic and enzyme inhibitors. And a lot of these drugs are polfeta inhibitors, ATM, ATR, CHK1, WEE1, meat inhibitors. Many of patients that may be joining the call have been involved in trials of these agents already, but there are many more that are being developed. And our goal is to, as much as possible, bring these strategies and bring these therapies to our patients. Secondly, another reason why we wanted to make the center is because there are multiple research questions that exist that are relevant to screening, early detection, genetics, prevention, biology of DNA repair, carcinogenesis, biology, immunobiology, drug resistance, quality of life, and survivorship. So, and these are some of the questions and some of the projects that we are right now doing and looking specifically for all of this to try and address different questions that are related to BRCA-related cancers, not just ovarian, but any cancer that has this, or any patient with cancers, with any type of cancer that have mutations in BRCA and related genes. Another reason why we wanted to do this is because while we all, Dana-Farber Cancer Disease Centers, are strong individually, we wanted to have a broader effort to address these research questions and develop and provide opportunities across different cancer types. And also to allow to have an opportunity to work for all of us together, bringing not only clinical scientists, but also translational and basic science collaborators at the same time. And also what we're trying to do in the center is bring new young faculty, as well as provide new educational opportunities for doctoral and postdoctoral trainees. So our vision is for our patients to improve outcomes, improve survival, quality of life, and also not only for our patients, but also for our family members of those patients who have both inherited and acquired mutations with these types of cancers. We want to facilitate growth and promote and grow our institution's exemplary care of patients with mutations in this and these types of cancers. Also strengthen collaboration, as I mentioned, and for our junior faculty to enhance career opportunities for research in this area. This is our BRCA Center logo. which highlights what we think is the key area for success for this center, and that is collaboration. This is an interdisciplinary, interdisease group collaboration across multiple Dana-Farber disease and research centers. And on the right, you see the key areas of research that are relevant to patients with BRCA-related cancers and our priorities for our center. We aim that our center is a catalyst so that we can bring all this together as harmonically intertwined as the two strands of the DNA in the double helix that you see in the center. We use the double helix in our logo because besides emphasizing collaboration, our motto is also relevant because BRCA and related genes play a critical role in repair of damage to the DNA, which is the double helix that you see in the middle. So I'm gonna switch gears now and talk about immunotherapy and specifically the work that we're doing with neoantigen vaccines. So what is the promise of immunotherapy? So one of the very important things that we have come to realize is that for the cancer cells to survive, they need to inhibit the T cells, which are the patient's normal immune cells who would otherwise recognize the tumor cell and kill it. So it's very, very important for the tumor to survive, in order to survive, to turn the immune system down, to essentially inhibit those T cells from attacking and destroying the tumor cells. So what we are trying to do is find drugs that block the inhibition of the T cells by the cancer cell, and therefore enable to activate the immune system so that the T cell can now activate and attack the tumor and kill the cancer cell. And this approach, I want to say, is very, very profound and can be very, very effective. Because many times immunotherapy, unlike chemotherapy, where we can have a very good response, but at some point the tumor may become resistant, with immunotherapy, if the immune system is trained appropriately to be able to attack and kill cancer cells, that effect can be many times for a long period of time. And that is the promise of immunotherapy. Many times it may not provide very quick response, or sometimes the response may last a little bit longer, or may not provide a response. But if that response happens, that response can be much more durable than the chemotherapy can offer. This is also another schematic, where essentially what we are trying to do is open the gates so that all these T cells, the green cells here, are able to attack the tumor cell, the red that you see in the middle. And I think there is no better story to say about this than the quote from former President Jimmy Carter, who said he had melanoma that had spread in his brain and his liver, and he had immunotherapy, and after immunotherapy, they didn't find any cancer at all. And he's been now in remission for more than 5 years. So, of course, the problem is that not all diseases are melanoma. And ovarian cancer is not melanoma. Most endometrial cancers are not melanoma, although there is a type of endometrial cancer that behaves like melanoma, and we can see very good responses with immune checkpoint inhibitors by giving them even by themselves. But again, not all ovarian cancers, not all endometrial cancers, and not all cervical cancers are melanoma. So we need to find, and that's one of the biggest priorities for research that we are trying to do, is to make immunotherapy work in ovarian cancer. And we have taken a lot of approach to do that by combining new agents with immunotherapy to make immunotherapy work better. So I'm gonna talk today about this combined neoantigen targeting cancer vaccines with immune checkpoint blockade in ovarian cancer. And I want to say this, that most people, when they hear the word vaccine, and obviously we talk about a lot about vaccines now with the COVID and all that, we think about preventing diseases rather than treating diseases that people already have. So the idea here, and the reason why we use the word vaccine, is because we're trying to help the immune system learn what the cancer looks like, overcome, in other words, the immunosuppression that the cancer cells have put on our immune system, stimulate the immune system using the vaccine so that the immune system can now attack the cancer and fight back. So that's why we're using the word vaccine. We're not trying to prevent cancer, we try to treat cancer. So that is the difference than vaccines that are used for other diseases. So this is the focus. I mentioned the word neoantigens. These are molecules that are present only in the cancer cells that are recognized by the immune system. And the neoantigens, and that's very, very important, they're expressed only on the cancer cells and not on the normal cells. And the reason why they're expressed in the cancer cells and not on the normal cells is because these come from mutations that exist in the DNA. And because there are mutations, then we have different proteins in the tumor cells, and these are different than what they are in the normal cell. So each patient has different mutation and therefore different neoantigens. And therefore, we thought that one good strategy to try and attack this is to create a vaccine, a personal vaccine, a personalized vaccine, as we call it, that for each patient recognize the mutation that exists in each patient, at least a number of those mutations, and therefore be able to stimulate the immune system to be very, very effective. We have developed a very sophisticated program to identify this neoantigen. So we take patients, we take a biopsy, we also take some blood, and we do very sophisticated sequencing of the DNA and RNA to identify tumor-specific mutations. We look at the HLA typing, we look at what type of immune cells the patient has, and we predict which of those personalized peptides can present it to the immune cells so that they can stimulate the immune system. After those peptides are recognized, then we create them, we synthesize them, and together with adjuvant substances like poly-ICLC, we give them to patients in order to stimulate their immune system. So the idea is here to try and drive these T cells, these immune cells, specifically into tumors. And our hypothesis is that we can use the vaccine as a steering wheel to drive the immune response towards the tumor, but at the same time, give this poly-ICLC to further augment it, but also give a drug called nivolumab to release the brakes that the tumor has put to the immune system. So it's a triple strategy to try to attack the tumor cells. And we have now launched this study that combines this vaccine with immunotherapy, with this immunotherapy drug called nivolumab. And what we are in as the first step trying to do is look at patients who have newly diagnosed ovarian cancer, who are candidates to receive neoadjuvant chemotherapy, as well as patients who have recurrent disease that is platinum sensitive. We have started this study already, and there are some patients who have started. We hope down the road to move this study to even more patients. And we're certainly very, very excited about this. I'm gonna finish by saying, and because I'm gonna open the floor for questions, I'm happy to take questions, to talk about this antibody drug conjugates, which are a type of drugs that are designed as a targeted therapy for treating cancer. But unlike chemotherapy, this antibody drug conjugates target and kill tumor cells while sparing normal cells. So the antibody drug conjugates are complex molecules that recognize that of an antibody that's linked to a chemotherapy drug. So as a first step, the antibody recognizes a molecule on the cancer cell, which is not expressed so much in the normal cells, and thereby targets the chemotherapy to the cancer cell and not the normal cells. So the antibody drug conjugate combines the targeted ability of the antibodies with the cancer killing ability of the chemotherapy, and can discriminate between healthy cells and tumor cells. And that's very important to avoid toxicity. So one antibody drug conjugate in ovarian cancer has been this drug called mirvetuximab, which targets folate receptor 1. And this is a drug that some patients have participated in clinical trials. We have now some very promising results, and I expect that very, very shortly, we will have an approval of this drug for ovarian cancer patients whose tumor overexpress this folate receptor. Another type of drug called tisotumab, which is another antibody drug conjugate, was recently approved September 20, 2021 in cervical cancer, and it's now being used for this disease. So I wanted to share this as a very promising strategy to promote for these tumor types. So I'm just gonna stop here and I'm gonna see whether there are any questions. So are there, Katie, can you hear me?
Yes, there are some questions in the chat. I don't know if you see them there or if you'd like to.
I see them now. So I'm just going to start. So could you talk about people with Lynch syndrome? I was just diagnosed with a PMS2 mutation with no cancer in my limited family tree, mainly concerned about ovarian because it is so hard to screen for. So absolutely. Lynch syndrome is another hereditary syndrome associated with certain mutations. There is a risk for both ovarian and endometrial and colorectal cancer associated with this syndrome. It is something that I don't know what the age is and what it is, but certainly, after childbearing, one of the things that can be considered is, close to menopause, it could be considered to remove the ovaries and remove the uterus. That's one of the things that can be considered in this case. Obviously, there is a risk for colon cancer as well with this syndrome, and that's something that needs to be acknowledged. One of the good things about this, and that goes together with the question that Lorraine asked, which type of endometrial cancer is like melanoma? And this, the type of endometrial cancer that is like melanoma is that associated with Lynch syndrome. So there are certain endometrial cancers that happen in patients who have the Lynch syndrome, but also some endometrial cancers on patients who have what we call deficiency or MLH1 promoter hypermethylation. That happens in about 20 to 25% of patients with endometrial cancer. And this has been checked very, very easily. And these patients, so those who have the Lynch syndrome and those who have this mismatch repair deficiency, can respond very, very well to immunotherapy, almost as well as patients with melanoma, if not even better than patients with melanoma. Again, not all patients with melanoma will respond to this. Not all patients with mismatch repair deficient and Lynch syndrome patients will respond to this, but there is a very, very good chance. And if patients have the Lynch syndrome or if patients have the mismatch repair deficiency, and this is an easy test to look at using looking at the tumor with immunohistochemistry or other ways to detect that. Another way is, how does this research apply to those with clear cell ovarian cancer? So that's a great question. So clear cell ovarian cancers is a very, very unique subtype. We now have, we understand more about clear cell ovarian cancer. It is true that usually this disease is not driven by BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, although there are very rarely some patients who do have BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations or mutations in these BRCA-related genes, but for the most part, clear cell ovarian cancers do not have these mutations. However, there are some other targets that clear cell ovarian cancers can have. For example, about 10% of clear cell ovarian cancers can be mismatch repair deficient and can respond very well to immunotherapy. So we have actually, in the NCCN guidelines for ovarian cancer now, have recommended that all patients with clear cell ovarian cancer have their tumor tested for mismatch repair deficiency to make sure that immunotherapy is or may not be an option for them. So mismatch repair deficiency is one target. It can be clear cell ovarian cancer can sometimes be associated with a Lynch syndrome that we were talking about before. In fact, usually the ovarian cancer that develops in the Lynch syndrome is either clear cell or endometrioid ovarian cancer. Another target that can happen in clear cell ovarian cancer is that we can have what we call HER2 amplification. HER2 is a gene that can be amplified in some patients. It's mostly amplified in certain types of breast cancer, but we now know it's amplified in clear cell ovarian cancer, and there are drugs now that can target this HER2 amplification if it exists in patients with clear cell ovarian cancer. There are also other mutations that can exist in patients with clear cell ovarian cancer. For example, mutations in the PI3K pathway. And there are drugs that we have and could be available to be treated. Again, it's very, very important to look at the tumor, do the testing at the DNA, and try to see whether some or all of these alterations are present to try and address those in addition to the standard chemotherapy that we currently use. So I'm happy to share the slides after the talk. If cancer cells inhibit T cells, does that mean that cancer patients are at a greater risk of other diseases due to a dampened immune system, even when not in active treatment? Yes, so that's a great question. We do not have, the dampening of the immune system is really related mostly against the cancer. So we do have some data. In fact, we're working on a manuscript right now that in fact, the cancer cells having a big, a higher tumor volume, a higher amount of cancer can decrease a little bit the response of the immune system even against other infections. but that's not to a very high degree. So I would say that a cancer patient has a relatively dampened immune system, but not significantly dampened, a mildly dampened immune system related to the presence of the cancer. Obviously, the biggest decrease in the immune system happens because of chemotherapy or other therapies that drop the count, but the cancer itself can decrease a little bit the ability of the immune system to fight infection, any infection, not just the Omicron variant. But I wouldn't worry too much. I would do the vaccine that as everybody I'm sure has done, and do the prevention and go from there. A recurrent ovarian cancer, should I look into this development with you? Do you look at former? I'm always happy. By the way, these are not things that I do only. I mean, all the doctors at Dana-Farber have access to these developments. I'm more than happy, obviously, if you're a patient, if I have seen before or you've been seen by Dana-Farber, one Dana-Farber oncologist, you're always a Dana-Farber oncologist, and you're always a Dana-Farber patient, so you feel free to call and let us know at any point and go from there. Terry had a question about, can you speak about research going on high-grade serous with known mutations? So a lot of these things are happening right now. I mentioned about the antibody drug conjugates. So for tumors that do not have the BRCA mutations, we have these drugs that could be given for patients. We have high expression of folate receptor, sometimes high expression of HER2. We do the oncopanel to look at mutations in specific specific genes, and we try to harmonize treatment. If those mutations do not exist, then we look at other approaches, like Terry went in this Regeneron study, which was a different type of immunotherapy, and she has been doing very, very well with that. So alternative immunotherapy approaches, different chemotherapy approaches can also be done. At this point, when we decide to expand the neoantigen vaccine trial, we will certainly let you know. Right now, the vaccine trial only happens for patients who are newly diagnosed or for patients who have relapsed platinum sensitive disease. This is something that we're trying to move this forward. Can you say anything about the utility of immunotherapy for endometrial adenocarcinoma with KRAS mutation? So we have a lot of immunotherapy. Now the combination of pembrolizumab and lenvatinib have shown activity in a number of endometrial cancers. And it's now FDA approved for tumors that are not mismatch repair deficient. So it's interesting. There was a small paper came out on two patients who happened to have the KRAS mutation and responded very well to pembrolizumab lenvatinib. So I would certainly consider this this immunotherapy for the pembrolizumab and lenvatinib, which is FDA approved, or any other form of immunotherapy if the lenvatinib is not able to be tolerated. I would certainly consider this combination. Obviously, KRAS mutation, there is a pill called trametinib. We have clinical trials that can combine this with other pills for this. Stage 2A ovarian cancer, why are immunotherapies only available to ovarian cancer with advanced stages? So first of all, it's great that that Celeste was diagnosed at an early stage. Unfortunately, right now, we don't know how well immunotherapies work for ovarian cancer, and that's why we only have them available for advanced stage disease. So for someone who has stage 2A, who almost certainly has a very good chance of already being cured of this disease, we would not risk her putting her on immunotherapy and risk toxicity when these patients have very, very good chance of responding already to the current treatment with chemotherapy. Do these vaccines work when ovarian cancer is metastatic, specifically stage 4? Yes, the patients with stage 4 metastatic disease are not excluded from this as long as they are newly diagnosed or they have recurrent platinum sensitive disease. So that's not something that we use as exclusion. Now, whether they work well or not, we don't know. That's something that's why we're doing the study to try and understand. I have been hearing about a vaccine being given in Germany. Is this the same as what is being used at Dana-Farber? I don't think this is the same. I don't know exactly what type of vaccine is being given in Germany, but I do know that this strategy with neoantigen vaccine is only done here at Dana-Farber. I'm happy to take any other questions. I don't know, Katie, are we allowed to have people even talk, or is it only going to be through the chat?
It is only through chat, just to protect privacy, because this is recorded.
Okay, that's fine. Because honestly, to be honest, I mean, we see the patients' names here, so I think everybody. So ATR inhibitor studies. There are ATR inhibitor studies currently ongoing through the So we have them through the Center of Clinical Trial Innovation, our phase one study. We do not have an ATM inhibitor study yet, but hopefully these drugs have been a little bit toxic, the ATM inhibitors so far, but the ATR inhibitors, we do have clinical trials open both in the GYN program as well as the CCTI, the phase one program. Of course, there are specific eligibility criteria. Any tips to prevent cancers after treatment? So that's a great question. I personally tell my patients, after the treatment has completed, I do not recommend any specific diets. I hear a lot of things or through the internet that I don't personally endorse. I think a balanced diet that is a healthy, balanced diet that's relatively, that is not rich in carbohydrates and that's rich in fruits and vegetables would be the way to go. I think that exercise is also good to consider. I tell my patients to exercise about 4 days, at least 4 days a week. A 30-minute walk is great. Again, we don't have great data that this works in specific cancers, but overall, in a number of cancers, this has been a good strategy. So I think leading a healthy lifestyle is an exercise is the way to go, and everything, I always say everything in moderation. Any drugs that target the P10 mutation, which seems quite common in many GYN cancers. So this has been a very difficult problem because we had a lot of this PI3K pathway inhibitors in the past, especially in the endometrial cancers. But unfortunately, those drugs by themselves did not work very well. So what we are doing right now is we are combining them with other drugs. So we have drugs, for example, a drug called everolimus or Afinitor that works well with endocrine therapy and can work, can be a good option to consider for patients who have a P10 mutation. Another drug that can be considered in terms of a clinical trial is a drug called alpelisib, which is combined with olaparib, and we do have a clinical trial called EPIC-O for patients with platinum-resistant ovarian cancer that these patients get a drug, alpelisib, that targets the PI3K pathway together with a PARP inhibitor. Another study we will be opening is an ATR inhibitor with a PI3K inhibitor study. This study will probably open in 3 to 4 months. And that study will obviously be a good strategy also for patients who have a P10 mutation. What might work best for metastatic endometrial cancer? Again, that will be something that will depend on the type of endometrial cancer. I mentioned they can be mismatch repair deficient. They can be mismatch repair proficient. They can be different histologies. Sometimes there are even BRCA mutations or HRR-related mutations in this tumor. Sometimes even PARP inhibitors can work. So it's a very big question. So it really depends on what we find in the type and the presence or absence of specific mutations. Results of ATR inhibitor trials for relapsed BRCA patients. So the ATR inhibitor studies as single agents have not really shown very good activity, but in combination with PARP inhibitors, they seem to be very, very promising. We're trying to figure out the ideal doses to give because there's still toxicities. But for patients who have BRCA mutations, I think that there is a very good opportunity for them to go in an ATR inhibitor trial, preferably in a combination with a PARP or another agent. Are these treatments for maintenance or just recurrence? So some of these treatments are for recurrence. The for maintenance therapy, right now we have only hormonal therapy for certain types of ovarian cancer and endometrial cancer, as well as PARP inhibitors for certain types of ovarian cancer. So immunotherapy can sometimes be used for maintenance, but it's not yet FDA approved in this setting. Well, I want to thank you all also very much for participating today. I hope this was helpful. My goal is to say to everyone that we're doing everything we can to bring new treatments for our patients. I think the right approach, and I tell that to all of my patients, is to always be positive and optimistic about the disease and not allow this disease to beat you in mentally. I think this is very, very important, and I wish you all the best. You're all in gray hands. You're all in gray hands, and you know, we will stay positive and continue to. I want to wish all of you happy holidays and be safe.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Konstantinopoulos, and to everyone for joining. We will distribute this recording and the one from last month within the next few weeks, and we'll have additional events coming up in the next few months as well. Take care, everyone. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.